Hey guys, John Rock and TV1 here with my snowblower box. This happens to be a Cub Cadet 450 snowblower, 45 inch snowblower with a 14 inch auger. And we are doing some modifications to it because it's necessary. It's old, used, and the old guy that had it before cobbled everything together. So before I can trust this thing out in my back 40, I have to do a bunch of this stuff. You can look, see behind me, that's the tractor that it's going on. It says Cub Cadet on it, but it is actually a white GT 1855. And therefore, that's why it probably says Cub Cadet on it. I believe that the old guy that got the tractor, somebody had put this Cub Cadet snowblower on it, and I found some Cub Cadet part numbers on the chute. None of the stickers were left on it, so there were no part numbers to go by. But after hunting snowblowers for this 1995 machine, which built by MTD in the mid-90s, they call it a MTD 990 or a 998, depending on the transmission. And staring at those two microfiche breakdowns pot lists, they cross over to some Cub Cadet part numbers, and after searching that stuff up, I decided that this was a Cub Cadet 450 snowblower, and that is different from the 451 snowblower, which is just the gearbox in the back. And so I'll show you everything that I've done here.
Okay, so that is the tractor that it's going on, and you can see I spray painted it up yellow just because I didn't have a yellow tractor, and I didn't have any of the white stickers or anything that goes on there with that for that tractor. However, I've been adding weight to it, and it's got the chains on it, putting tubes and tires, and you can see the big giant 3/4 ton Chevy brake drum, brake rotors on the back. That and some 70 pounds of steel that I got welded together into a big lump in there for wheel weights. MTD says they got 50 pound wheel weights or 75 pound wheel weights, and I know just from running my Suburbans that that is not enough for that tractor to come up and down my hill pushing a blade or anything else. So, to the snowblower. Okay, so the gig on this is, it is the 45 inch blower box, and if you see there, if you look close, you can see what looks like some fiberglass paper on there, and this big lumple that's right there. And any of these snow blowers that got used on a gravel driveway, this is pretty rugged steel, but it seems that something will go around in there and it will wad out that spot in the drum, and then of course the paint falls off of it and it rusts. And so it had some pinholes in it, and the old guy that had this made a mess with that fiberglass stuff there. He didn't bother pulling the impeller out and the auger and all that stuff to get in there, and so there was like paper mache hanging everywhere around there. So that being said, I gutted the box, took everything apart. There's the impeller over there, and I did some welding on it. And that impeller is a 14 inch impeller, and you can actually still get that in MTD. If you look for the parts from my white tractor, they cross that number to a 14 inch impeller, still available for Cub Cadet. I, however, have welded some flat stock on there to tighten up the clearances. Also, I use this here Bondo Mar Glass stuff, I call it. I used to call it Mar Glass. Maybe that was a brand name, but it's short strand reinforced fiberglass filler. And only not even a half an hour ago, you could see this is still, but this is unhardened. And I tried to get as much out of the can as possible. Watered the whole court right inside there and spread it around on this here box with some piece of plastic that I had laying around. You can't get off. That stuff is like steel. And they say do it at 45 degrees or above. And it's, today is actually a nice day out here, but it's only about 50, so I got this lamp light in there. And we're only 20 minutes or a half an hour, and this stuff is like steel. Like steel. I had the old guy use that, you know, to try to, he didn't even try to fill the gap in there. And there was about a half an inch of gap, between the impeller, and some of you guys know if you're doing the snowblower mods to try to get them to throw better, this here is one of the things is you're trying to close up that gap. And I had to put a couple of new studs in here, which I tacked in with the welder, so I could get my gearbox on. You could see they were grinding in over here, and they had the thing upside down. Whoever put this onto this tractor, onto the white tractor, had the gearbox upside down. And it is shaft driven. So that is this here, PTO shaft. And it had this giant angle in a shaft with brand new universal joints. I think the old guy died and he never got to use this tractor. And thank God, you know, I mean, these brackets, the cam brackets are on backwards. This is supposed to be on over here so that you got an amount of float up and down when you're on the ground. It rides over stuff a little bit up and down. And he had them backwards, you know, from side to side of the tractor. This is what's left of the lift rod, and you can see on this side here, this sleeve spins. Over here, it's all rotted, welded on there, and that I tried to cut it in the lathe and get it to move with the vibrate hammer, and it didn't budge. So I don't know exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to smooth that out. Maybe I'm going to stick it in the coal stove because I don't have any acetylene, but we might try that and see if I can get that sleeve to move. If not, I don't have time for everything, so next year we'll make new shaft. This, however, is getting a new shaft this year, and this is the lift part, and it goes in these holes here. However, under the tractor, when I had it temped up mounted on there, it was making all kinds of creaky noises, and you could see where it was riding. I don't know, but this shaft, this part of the mounting bracket, it seems to be correct from white. It's got the right thing on the back there. However, this is just regular 2x3 box, and they had these four holes. I don't know what that is, but I decided I'm going to make this new plate, and I need to space that off the machine another inch and a half so that I can get this to slide, and I can actually remove the drive shaft from the snowblower box without having to unmount the whole machine. This is a slip joint, that's what that's for, and that's how that's supposed to work. I was also missing the circlips inside right in here, which I had to go buy and put circlip in there and to keep that shaft where it's supposed to be. The gig of the difference between a 450 snowblower and a 451 is the gear ratio. The 451 ratio, I believe, is 2.58:1. Rotate this 2.5 times, get one out the other side there. This is the 186, 1.86:1 ratio. So you can figure that out just by spinning this and counting that. And yeah, you can pretty probably do that while it's on the machine. So we are going to mount this plate. We're going to get this so that this can be taken on and off. The blower box can be removed from this without having to I had to cut all these bolts out, which is why this project's taking longer. We're going to move this out here like this, square it up because the blower box was crooked. So I want my drive shaft to live because they can't be had anymore. And we're going to make this on the blower box with these here slots so that we can pull it on and off without having to rip everything off, just in case I come across a plow blade that may or not go on there. But we are going to make that new shaft in there. We're going to cut that out of there and get that piece of swill out of there. And we're going to make it longer by about this much. And after this gets temped on the machine and we find out where them shafts are going to ride, then we punch new holes for pins, which you can see how beat this is. And there ain't hardly no metal left there. And while I don't have a whole lot of time, it's almost Thanksgiving out here in southern New Hampshire, we are going to make this work as best as possible. So I'll bring you back when I get a couple more things. We're going to just clean the zits out of there, and then we're going to make shear pins, and I'm going to show you that too. I bought some grade 5s, and it's a good thing I took them out because I already measured these ones at the store that are supposedly go for this thing. So I got all the numbers. We're going to make them grade 5s and cut the knot. 5/16, we're going to cut them down to 240 at the slots where they go in them shafts and make this work. You can see this auger was put together. That auger there has the notches in it for the, you know, what they call them, ice crusty breakers or whatever there. And this one doesn't. So somebody put this thing together and they just did a lot of cheesing out. So we're trying to take the cheese out of it and make this thing work. Yeah, so now I made that plate down there out of what I had laying on the floor here, some quarter inch stuff. And you can see by the holes that it had to move that far to get me that beauteous, almost no angle drive shaft, almost a straight shot with the blower in the working mode. And I got just enough room to detach the... you pull that little collar toward yourself, and if everything's all lubricated like it's supposed to be, the little ball bearing comes out and you can pull that off without having to push the tractor. And that's the point, that if I didn't undo the back, the giant bolt in the back that's in the trailer hitch spot, can I undo that drive shaft and use it for something else, or unhook it, or fix it, or whatever. However, if I did not do this work, I would have had to unhook all of the linkages, undo that big giant bolt in the back, and then I could get the drive shaft off. And if I wanted to put this on after I take this, like take all of that undercarriage off, I would have to drive the tractor up, leave it in neutral, and hook the drive shaft and hope the tractor doesn't walk away from me, because I'd have to have enough room to get that going on there. So, and yeah, I swelded these here uprights on so that I had something to hang weights off of. Because you guys maybe saw in my other video that I made that there. That is a one-ton engine hoist that I turned into a skid and crane with the hook on the back. And without that, with that on there and trying to pick up a log on the back, you're doing a wheelie right to the sky. So I had to have somewhere to hang some weight on the front, and them no 35 little pound dinky weights was gonna do it on there. Just ain't gonna do it. So yeah, so that's where we're at. Okay, so she's been squared, centered forever. I got marks here so that everything goes back where it's supposed to go on the blower box and on this thing here. And when you know, this plans on getting mounted, I made it this way so that I could take it apart, so that when the time comes to fix that blower box, that I can actually unbolt it and put it back together after I fix the welded drum. So the next process here after welding this up, because I just feel like it, is to go ahead and cut this thing out of here and make new shaft and put in there and make it so that it's actually an inch longer on both sides, or inch and a half, because I got plenty of shaft. And that way, these will actually be straight in the tractor instead of all lean tipped in. I don't know what was going on there, but you can tell by the wear pattern that was on this that they were not riding straight. And when I bolt this up into the track, the temp like, I'm going to try to fix this here somehow. Maybe I'm going to stick it in my coal stove and try to glow that off of there or something. But you could see it was running just barely on these slippy slidey things here. And it was on, you know, like on in here. And that just doesn't make for the tractor have a nice time pick up down. And now it's going to. Yeah. So, yeah.
A little bit preheat, likely not that hot steel there. I was gonna buy it up something else to beat it up with, but whatever.
Nice.
More feed on the feed. Wow, wire. If it'll be something, it'll be everything. You name it.
You name it. It is what it is.
Yeah, what else is new? What else is new? Start something, gotta do something else. You know what it is. It's the beauty of it. The beauty of all. Yeah. Try that again. Okay, so I guess you guys had no flash burn, I'll show you the finish.
Yeah, ain't real pretty, but he's glued on there good. Yeah, anybody want to know about the heat in that welder there? Supposedly 180, and I think it's all of that. I don't know if you're seeing the blue stain there from the heat, but you see it. Yeah, penetration. Yeah, and that was round tubing, so I had to make that root weld down in there and then cover it over. So, yeah. All right. Next problem. Cut that pin out of there. Make a fresh one. Yes, sir. Longer. So that we can locate that temp up in the tractor, locate the arms so that they're actually straight with the hangers instead of, they're all in there cattywampus doing this sort of thing. And so it's binding up when it's coming up and down. It ain't supposed to do that. It's supposed to go straight, parallel. Yeah, we're gonna fix it. Yep, that didn't work out too bad. I was a little worried that my circle was, after grinding off that pile of weld, that she was going invisible on me. So I mocked it up, blued it up to make center with a couple of spots that I could see, the pinholes from the three-quarter circle, and center punched it just in case I had to drill it to get low enough below the weld there. Didn't really want to do that. And after getting through to the other side, she just pounded out. So it worked out nice. Three pieces I ended up with. Two cutoff ends and a center that was left in there. So I don't know, we make some crap out of that later. 3/4 into 1/2 inch something. But so we got this beauty little 3/4 rod. And we're gonna pound us a piece of this in there. We might open this hole a little bit to make sure she goes in good nice. And 14-inch parts we're going to put in there. That way then I can trim off a little bit, put taper on end. And then once I get my bracketry under the tractor all squared up in there nice, then I will go ahead and just drill it on the floor for some hairpins. What do you call it? Yeah. Right, so we're gonna relieve that hole a little bit so we can get this beauty 3/4 rod in there. And like I was trying to say there, this here came out in three pieces. There's the center part, what's left of it. And I was a little worried it was going invisible on me there. So we're gonna relieve this hole a little bit so I can get this in there and it's doesn't dry. I don't get a problem stuck halfway through the hole. We'll see how's this working this hole here. It doesn't go. So they might have been just under 3/4 on that. And I guess we'll try my arms. How's that gonna work in there? Oh, that worked perfect. So we don't want to do nothing to that shaft. We want to make that fit. So what we'll do is we'll just fix them holes. That's what we'll do. Yeah. And supposedly I'll be able to fix this hole. What does that say? Right, stays. Oh, this one here don't have the 3/4 on it. I gotta go get me another one.
There's my three conical 11/16. That's all they give me is it on that one. Maybe all I gotta do. How's that work? Am I gonna be able to drag that in there? Probably not. She's gonna get stuck. You know that will happen. Then I'll have me a nice mushroom dent, but we'll put us a little champ in there to get some welding. And yeah. We want it to fit in there nice so she stays composite straight. Find me three-quarter drill bit just to scrape through that hole a little bit. Because I'm thinking that may have been a shad undersize.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, we'll use this battery-operated drill so I don't break my arm like I did last year. Yeah. All I want to do is just blow the side nut on that hole just to make our bar fit nice. Give it a little tap up here and see what happens. Yeah, we gotta give her a little more because she's gonna get stuck somewhere there in the middle. Like I said, we don't want that to happen. Beautiful keyless chocks that I think my corn grips a third time than that. I think we're gonna clean the other side out a little bit the same way. Yeah, I see any air around that. If I can see something, then we're gonna drive it. Oh yeah, okay, one side, there it is. Oh, and she fits perfect, nice and tight. So yeah, we're gonna make this a 14 inch pot, like I said, put taper on both ends there and not. Yeah, then weld her in. Glue her right up in there, boy.
Uh-huh.
Slowly killing this project, right? Slowly killing it off. I said again how much I love this clock school gun welder. You guys want to see what kind of welder this is? I'm not a welder, I'm not trained at all, I'm just been practicing gluing metal together. And once I kneel down, if I don't have a thing, this is a plow frame, so we'll test my ground over there. I guess it works good. Okay, good. Nice tack. Do the same over here. So nothing moves on me. Yeah. Whatever.
I have never had a problem with this welder hitting the duty cycle at all. It don't. Things don't want to work good for me.
So just in case anybody wants to actually see what that looks like, it's glued on there pretty good enough for what it is. Now I gotta replace a couple of bolts in here that somebody left out of it. Squeeze this together with the clamps, get it bolted in tight so that it stays straight under the tractor. And we are just about ready for a temp fitting.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay, a couple of pots that I so far seem to have sort of neglected talking about was these here skid shoes. And you can see that somebody ground them right off to nothing on both sides. There's like nothing left of these here. So, how are we going to fix that? Well, while I'm still in the welding mood, that's all we are going to do is weld some rebar right on there. And we're going to put a straight piece in there and then bend around so that I can get some more bite out of these here because I have a gravel driveway, so I need to keep my thing up an inch until I get some sort of ice base going on there, and then I can slide up a bit and take down. But for now, these things, I need to get some bite, and you can see I got almost nothing left there. And after some trial fitting, putting some 1-inch stock under the blower box there, there was not going to be any holes left to bite onto. So we're going to fix that right now. So what are we going to use? Well, we're going to use some of this really cheap rebar. This is half inch stuff. I probably would have liked to have gone with 3/4. As a matter of fact, the skid shoes on my Suburban with the Roper snowblower, which you guys can see here in some sort of competition with this thing when we get some snow, I built up those shoes with some pieces of old leaf springs, and they're big, wide, flat, and this here is this kind here. So the deal of it is that I don't have any acetylene oxygen torches here to heat stuff with, so I either got to do it in my coal stove, I'm not worried about doing that. And half-inch rebar is about all I can bend on my little vise without tearing the wall out and stuff. So that's what we're going to do, is we're going to make some straight pods to build up with. And then I am going to bend another half-inch pot around that. And this piece here will get welded on rugged. The other thing will just get tacked on. That way I don't have to do a bunch of grinding when it comes time to fix that. You can see somebody else did the same thing once upon a time, too, and ate them right off. So, yeah. But why are we doing this? Well, because I'm cheap and I don't trust this machine yet. And if I did, I might try to actually buy something like this. But why would I spend $60 for these here shoes on my gravel driveway, which I know I'm going to eat them up? So, yeah. And a little bit of the interim photo. Put that root piece on there, and then we're going to tack that on there and smash those ends down with the big mallet. Pom, 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 connect them together. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Nice little booties for the snow box. Yeah.
This might not work. I might have to put this back in the vice for this. Crack. One. Yeah, still got about one. Nice. Okay, little tack, and done.
That's it.
Done. Done. Done on that one. Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, button up your cables if you can stand it. Tack, flip it over, do the same thing. I don't know why. Is it necessary? Probably not. That's coming apart. I just don't think so. Just don't think so. Any more than necessary for that thing to skid you? I just don't think so. Yeah. Nice. I don't have an anvil, so I got to use one of these here nice stumps. Nice old oak stump. We're good. Same thing my bench is built out of. Nice. Here we go. That's what she looks like, ladies and gents.
Homemade chair pins come out.